Hello and welcome to the session. This is Professor Farhad, in which we would look at the dividend discount model. Before we start, I would like to remind you to connect with me on LinkedIn if you haven't done so, and please subscribe to my YouTube. If you like my lectures, please like them and share them. If they benefit you, it means they might benefit other people. On my website, farhadlectures.com, you will find additional resources, especially if you are studying for your CPA exam or if you are taking accounting courses. Also, if you'd like to find out how well is your university performing at the CPA exam, please check out my website. So what is the dividend discount model? It's basically a formula stating that the intrinsic value of a firm equal to the present value of all the expected future dividend. This sounds something that we learned about before. What does it sounds like? It sounds like when we value stocks, when we find the price, I'm sorry, not stocks, bonds. When we find the price of the bond, remember the price of the bond is the present value of the payment, is the present value of the payments, which is we call those an annuity, plus the present value of the face value, which is basically a single payment. Simply put, on a timeline, if we're valuing a bond, if we want to find the price of the bond, we look at the payments, and all these dashes are payments. I don't know. Let's assume those are 30 payments. It's a 15-year bond. Assume this is 15-year bond, and each payment is $100. So each X, each dash is $100. And at the end, you'll get your face value. Therefore, what you do is you discount your payment, and you discount your face value to the present, and this will be the price of the bond. The dividend discount model practically sound the same. Basically, it's the present value of all expected future dividend. Basically, and for the bond pays interest. We discount the interest. For the stocks pay dividend. So basically, you should be familiar with this overall concept. Also, in the prior session, we looked at the value of a stock or the price of a stock, V, you could say P0. The price of a stock, we learned that the price of the stock, to find the price of the stock, if we know the future dividend, how much we're going to be paid in dividend, and we can estimate the future price at P1, we discount at 1 plus K. Remember, K is the required rate of return. And this way, we can find the price of the stock today. So simply put, the price of the stock is the dividend discounted, which is, simply put, it's D1 over 1 plus K plus P1 over 1 plus K. So it's the discount of the dividend plus the discount of the price. You discount those to the present and you will find the price of the stock today, P0. So what happened if you want to find the price a year from now? Not today, you want to know what's the price a year from now. Well, the price a year from now equal to D2, the dividend that you're gonna be receiving a year from now, which is D2, notice this is P1, D2, plus the price of the end of the year, again, discounted at 1 plus K. And hopefully you are starting to see a trend. And let's put this trend on a timeline, just as we did with the bond, to see how this works from the stock's perspective. So simply put, if we have a timeline, this is P0, and P0 is today. How do we find, and this is P1, let's say this is P2, so on, P3, P4, so on and so forth. So how do we find P0? Well, we have to find, for P0, we have to discount P1 and discount D1, discount those two. How do we find P1? Well, to find P1, we have to discount P2 and D2. Well, how do we find P2? Think about it, P2 is we have to find P3, discount P3 and discount D3. And how do we find P4? You got the point. P3, we discount P4 and D4. So simply put, what's going to happen is this. So if this is P1, if this is the formula for P1, if we want to find the stock price today, 2 years into the future, here's what we do. We're going to discount the D1, which is this part here, plus P1, plus the discount of P1. So what we do is we discount. So notice here, this area here that I highlight in green, it's this part here, plus P1, discounted. Well, P1, notice P1 in this formula, equal to D2 plus P2 over 1 plus K. So we can replace P1. So notice P1 here is replaced by, let me use this a different color. So P1 can be replaced by this circle here. So P1 equal to D2 plus P2 divided by 1 plus K. So it's going to be the dividend year from now plus the dividend 2 years from now plus the price 2 years from now. So if we want to find the price, if we're discounting the price 2 years from now. Now we could do the same thing for the price 3 years from now. Simply put, if we want to find the price 3 years from now, we can find the same thing. Simply put, the price today, which is P0, let's say value 0 or P0, equal to the present value of the dividend. D1 divided by 1 plus K, which is discounted by the required rate of return, D2, D3, D4, D5. Now what happened in this formula, we're only counting the dividend. We kind of drop out the price, P2, is because we assume the price is part of the dividend. It's discounted as part of the dividend. But basically what we do, this is what, in its simplistic format, this is the dividend discount model, which is the dividend, all the dividend, equal to the present value of all the expected dividend. When we take the present value of the dividend and we discount them to the present value, we find the price of the stock based on the dividend discount model. So this is the idea. You'll take your dividend and you discount them to the present value. Pretty simple in a sense that it's very similar to the bond. Simply, if we're comparing it strictly to the bond, think of only discounting the interest, not the face value. Now, here's the question to you. Do dividends stay constant? So simply put, here we are saying D1 plus D2 plus D3 plus D4. But do dividends stay constant? And the answer is no. Dividend, they don't stay constant for many reasons. The company makes profit. As they make more profit, they distribute more dividend. Also, we have something called the dividend yield. As the stock price goes up in value, the company will have to increase the dividend to compensate for the price. So the normal thing, dividend they trend upward. So we're going to assume dividend trend upward at a stable rate that we call G. So G is the growth rate of dividend because dividend don't stay the same. Here we are assuming the dividend, you know, D1, D2, it's all the same. For example, if the growth rate of the dividend is 5%, simply put, the company will increase their dividend for 5%. And the most recently paid dividend, D0, is $3.81. What can we say about D1? Well, D1 equal to D0, which is 3.81 times 1 plus the growth rate, which is 5%. So D1 equal to $4. D2, D0 plus 1 plus G raised to the second power, which is 3.81 times 1.05 raised to the second power. What is the third dividend? Well, it's D0 plus 1 plus the growth rate raised to the third power, 441, so on and so forth. This is assuming the growth is constant. It means it's the same growth rate, which is at 5%. So here's what we can say. We can say that V0, now this is, we're going to be including the growth rate. V0, again, when I say V0, value zero, it means the price today, P0, equal to the D0 plus 1 plus the growth rate divided by 1 plus K. So basically, you'll take the future, the present dividend, you grow it, and you discount it. You will take, I'm sorry, not the future dividend. Yes, the future dividend in a sense that it's D times 1 plus G, which is the current dividend plus the growth raised to the second power divided by 1 plus K raised to the second power. Again, D0 plus 1 plus G, the growth rate raised to the third power, so on and so forth. Now we can simplify this equation into this equation. V0, we can say equal to the future dividend, which is the dividend growth, D0 plus D0 times 1 plus G divided by K minus G. So this formula here basically can turn into this formula, and basically it can be simplified to the price of a stock. So we can find the price of a stock today, which is equal to the future dividend based on the dividend growth, 1 plus G, divided by K, and we'll take it into account the growth in the denominator, 1 minus G. So simply put, from all of this, you need to understand the price of the stock equal to its future dividend divided by K, the required rate of return, minus the growth rate of the stock. Now we can compute the intrinsic value. And again, once we say the intrinsic value, it means we're calculating the stock price today by dividing D1, no, not D0, the future dividend, by K minus G. So if the market capitalization, which is the required rate of return K, is 12%, okay, the equation implies that the intrinsic value of the stock is as follows. We have $4, which is D1. All we have to do, find D1 divided by the required rate of return minus the growth rate minus G. It means the stock, the intrinsic value of the stock, equal to $57.14. So this formula, this is what we're going to go through. This formula equal to the constant growth model. It means the growth is constantly at 5%, it's called the Gordon model after the Miriam Gordon who popularized this model. So this is basically the basic idea of this dividend discount model or the constant growth model. Now, let's take a look at an example. Preferred stock, if you're not aware of them, they pay a fixed dividend that can be looked at a constant using we can find the price of the preferred stock by using this constant dividend discount model. Why? Because the growth rate is simply zero. The preferred stock, they pay you a fixed dividend. So when you buy a preferred stock, they will tell you, we're going to pay you $2. That's it. $2 forever. It's part of the contract. Therefore, for example, the value of preferred stock, well, they also use the $2, paying $2 when the discount rate is 8%. Notice we don't have G, G equal to zero. So the price of the stock, P0 equal to the dividend, and it doesn't have any growth. It's $2 divided by 0.08 minus zero, which is K minus G. We have no growth. Therefore, the price of the preferred stock equal to $25. How did we find this out? Based on the dividend discount model. We discounted the dividend using the required rate of return, and this dividend don't grow. Simply put, a preferred stock pay you a fixed dividend. Sounds like interest on a bond. Exactly. Sounds like an interest on a bond. So let's take a look at another example. High Flyer Industries had just paid annual dividend of $3. This is just paid it. The dividend is expected to grow at a constant rate of 8% indefinitely. That's G. The beta of the high flyer stock is 1. The risk-free rate is 6%, and the market risk premium is 8. Why are they giving us all this information? Because they want us to compute the required rate of return, which is using Cap M. So what is the intrinsic value of this stock? Well, because a $3 dividend had just been paid and the growth rate is 8%, the forecast for the year end is $3.24. So this is the one. So we find out already the numerator. The market capitalization rate, or K, or the required rate of return, equal to the, using the Cap M, risk-free rate of 6% plus 1, the beta times 8%, which is the 8% is what? 8% is the, what is the market, what's the, oh, risk premium, 8% right here, risk premium. So basically, K equal to 14%. Therefore, what we can say is D1, which is 324, divided by K minus G, 14% required rate of return minus the growth rate. So the price of this stock is $54. What would be your estimate of the intrinsic value if you believe that the stock was riskier with a beta of 1.25? Well, guess what? Now we're saying the beta is 1.25. What do we have to do now? We have to recompute the required rate of return. Let's do so. So if we recompute the required rate of return, we notice that K equal to 16%. What happened is K become 16. What happened here? The stock goes down. It's because it's riskier. You buy it at a discount. So because it's riskier, you want to buy it at a discount. So because risk comes with return, you want a higher return. So now 16 minus 3.24 divided by 16 minus 0.08, which is 0.08, equal to $40.50. So if the stock is riskier, you want to buy it at a discount. So you have a higher rate of return. More risk, more return. How would you earn more return? You pay less for the stock. So when it gives the return, you have a higher return when you pay less. Constant growth dividend implies that the stock value will be greater under those three conditions. Just basically, they're common sense, but you have to know them. Obviously, the larger its expected dividend per share. So the larger is the denominator. Think about it. What we say D1 divided by R minus G. If D1 is higher, P0 is higher, right? That hopefully this makes sense. The lower the market capitalization. So as this goes down, this goes up, the price goes up. So it, the required rate of return goes down, which is what we saw in the last example, because it means the stock is riskier, therefore we pay, imply that the value will be greater. Yes, the value will be greater. The lower is the K. If the K is lower, the price is greater. Actually, it's the opposite. We're taking less risk. The higher the expected growth, the higher the P0. Okay? So hopefully just make sure you understand this. And basically, if you don't understand or memorize them on the exam, just jot some numbers down. Say, well, what if I put 10? Divide, let's assume my dividend is 10 and my rate of return equal to 20.2 and my growth rate equal to 0.1 or 0.1, which is 10%, and start to change and see what happened to your stock price. So that's the easiest way to deal with. This is one, some of the implication of this model, the constant growth dividend model. Okay. Another implication of the constant growth dividend model is what? And hopefully kind of you're already kind of thinking about this, is that the stock price is expected to grow at the same rate as dividend. Why? Because we assume the dividend is what's driving the stock. So to see, suppose that the steady state stock is selling at intrinsic value of $57.14. So simply put, that's the intrinsic value, P0 equal to D1, K minus G. Notice that the price is proportional to the dividend. Therefore, next year when the dividend is paid to steady stock stockholders, where they're expecting a 5% growth. Let's see, if they're expecting 5% growth, what will be D2? It's $4 now, increased at 1.05. The future dividend is 4.2. Well, let's find the stock price. The future dividend, which is P1 equal to D2 divided by K minus G, 12 minus 5, and equal to $60. What does that mean, $60? $60 means if the stock moved from $57.14 to $60, compute the percentage increase, that's equal to 5%. That's equal to the growth rate. It means of the dividend. It means the stock is growing in proportion to the dividend. So we can say that P1 equal to D2 divided by K minus G, D2 equal to D1 times 1 plus G, because D2 will take the previous year dividend plus the growth. Also, if we simplify now, we find that D1, basically just break this formula down, put 1 plus G on the side. So notice here, D1 times 1 plus G. So D1 divided K minus G equal to P0. Remember to find this formula here gives you P0. D1 divided by K minus G equal to 0. Simply put, the price today equal to the price plus the future growth. So the price, the P1, it end up to be P0 times 1 plus the growth. All we have to do, if you know the growth of the dividend, take this, the current stock price multiplied by the dividend growth, and you will find P1. This is what basically what this formula, just you can go back and just see how we break down this formula, that this is what it breaks down to. So make sure you know this formula, this one right here. Therefore, DDM implies that when dividends are growing at a constant rate, the expected rate of price appreciation in any year will equal to the constant growth rate, G, for a stock whose market price equal to the intrinsic value. Obviously, the stock, that's assuming the stock price equal to the intrinsic value, which we find the intrinsic value based on the dividend growth. So they should equal to each other. Therefore, what we can say, the expected return equal to the dividend yield plus the capital gain yield. And hopefully we remember this from the prior session. So if we want to find the return on the stock, the expected return has two components. The dividend component, which is, again, if you, let's assume we have a stock, we paid $50 for a stock, and it pays $2 per share. So two divided by 50 equal to 4%, that's the dividend yield, that's this formula here, plus, let's assume the growth rate, we assume the growth rate for the stock is 2%, 2 plus 4 equal to 6%. So the expected return equal to the dividend yield plus the growth rate of the stock, if there's any growth rate. if there's any growth rate for this. Let's take a look at this example. IBX stock dividend at the end of this year is expected to be 2.15. So read this problem carefully. It's at the end of this year. It means this is D1. They're not talking about D0. They're giving you D1. It's expected to be $2.15 and expected to grow at 11.2 is the growth rate. If the required rate of return is 15.2, that's K, what is the intrinsic value? What is the intrinsic value of the stock? Basically, simply put, the formula is D1 K minus G. So what's the intrinsic value? We're giving D1, $2.15, divided by K, 15.2%, which is 0.152. Let's use decimal, 0.152 minus 0.112. So if we do this computation, we find out that the price today is $53.75. We call this P0 or V0, or the price today, or the intrinsic based on the intrinsic value. Okay, now we can compare this to the market price. We don't have the market price, but this is the intrinsic value. Well, the second question is this. If IBX current market price equal to the intrinsic value, that's good. What's the next year expected price? Well, that's easy. Why? Because if we are already told that the intrinsic value equal to the market value, it means the only growth is the growth of the dividend. It means if we take $53.75, which is the current price, P0, all we have to do is multiply this by 1 plus G, 1 plus the growth rate. That's all, which is equal to $53.75 times 1.112, which is equal to $59.77. So basically taking the P0 and multiplying it by a growth rate to find P1. P1 is the price next year. That's all, because they're equal to each other. Okay. If an investor were to buy IBX stock now and sell it after receiving the $2.15 a year from now, what is the expected capital gain? It means the price appreciation in percentage term. What is the dividend yield? And what would be the holding period? Now, what we have is this. We have how much is the stock price today? So the stock price today, let me put it today. Stock price today is $53.75. 1 year from now, equal to $59.77. Okay, so we have this information, and we know the dividend for this equal to $2.15. Now we have to find out the dividend yield, the capital gain yield. Well, let's start with the dividend yield. The dividend yield is you're going to be getting $2.15, and you paid for this stock $53.75. If we take 215 divided by 53.75, let me just do this calculation real quick, that's going to give us 4%. So the dividend yield is 4%. Now, we need to know the capital appreciation. How much did that stock increase in value? Well, we have to find the difference between $59.77 minus $53.75 divided by $53.75. Let me find the rate on this. So if I take this computation, the numerator is $6.02. So this is equal to $6.02 divided by 53.75. Let me do this. 53.75. That's equal to 11.2%. So what would be the holding? The holding is 4% plus 11.2%. Well, think about it. This is the growth, 11.2. This is, remember, the growth rate is 11.2, and the dividend yield is 4%. So the total holding period, is 15.2%. As always, I'm going to remind you to visit my website, farhadlectures.com, if you need additional resources. And if you're studying for your CPA exam, this topic is covered on the exam. Study hard, good luck, and stay safe.